Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We are commemorating the Black History Month with a panel of experts, legal experts, and civic rights experts who are going to talk to us about civil rights today. Their experience in legal and public world, and they will talk about their the cases they are familiar with. And later on, you will be allowed to ask any questions that will pertain to the topic we are talking. All right, let me explain who we have here today. On my left, Deborah Stephens Esquire. She's currently a legal counsel at Benjamin Moore Company. She's also an adjunct professor at Berklee College at the Legal Studies Department. Deborah worked for the New Jersey Attorney General Office for 10 years. Among her clients were various state agencies across the state of New Jersey, including the University of Medicine and Dentistry, Department of Human Services, Department of Corrections, and the State Police. Deborah graduated from Pace University School of Law and is licensed in New York and New Jersey. Yes? Yes. I got everything. I want to be correct with everything, guys. Sorry. All right. Next, we have Ms. Alexis Miller. She is a leader in the Black Lives Matter in Patterson. She received her degree from Rutgers University, where she majored in public policy with concentration on community development, race and ethnic studies, and film. While at Rutgers, Alexis was awarded the Civic Scholar Certificate for her commitment to public service and was chosen as the commencement speaker in 2015 for Edward Lustein School of Planning and Public Policy. Currently, Alexis researches mass atrocities prevention for the Global Center for the Responsibility to Protect. In addition to her work in international policy, she advocates for transparency and accountability through civilian complaint review boards to end police misconduct. Next, Alexis plans to pursue a degree in law, so we're going to have a next lawyer. Rosalyn Akalonu Esquire. Rose is a friend of mine. She's also a practicing defense attorney at New York State. Formerly, she was a Berklee College professor in the Justice Studies and Legal Studies Department, on-site and online. Rose is also an author of Pardon, a biography about one of the first African-American lawyers who successfully argued before the Supreme Court of the U.S. We have the book in the library. It's not big, guys. But it's very well researched. It's an easy read also. So if you want to read something uplifting, please stop by. Stephen B. Lowe Esquire worked in the Rockland County District Attorney's Office between 1976 and 84. Next, Mr. Lowe was an attorney at Damiani & Lowe, where he worked until 2008. Mr. Lowe specialized in medical malpractice and personal injury and criminal cases. Mr. Lowe has held many professional public positions. He is the past president of the Hudson Valley Council of the Boy Scouts of America, and he was also the past president of the Rockland Bar Association. Mr. Lowe retired last year from the Surrogate Court of Rockland County, where he worked as principal court attorney and referee. All right. I would like our speakers to add to whatever I said and tell us about your experience. We concentrate on civil rights, but it can be seen a little bit wider. So tell us about your work that you think pertains to that topic. Russ, do you want to go first? Russ is having to pick up a child, so she's not going to leave us in the middle. I don't think she just needs her priorities first.
Thanks, Maria. And it's good to be back at Berklee College. And I was told to not really speak about myself today. I think I was told to speak on the general topic of civil rights. Maria gave a nice short summary. I am an attorney practicing in Rockland County, admitted in New York State, and also admitted to the Supreme Court of the United States and the U.S. District Court, Southern District of New York. I joined my approximately 9 years here teaching in the Justice Studies Department, Legal Studies Department. Went to Howard John Jay College, criminal justice for my bachelor's and master's degree in criminal justice. So I'm gonna, I guess, just start off with the big topic of civil rights. And I think that you already know I may have to leave at some point because of a school bus issue. But I think the broad topic of civil rights, for me, a good place to start would be an anniversary that's coming up very soon, in just a few weeks. March 6th is the 160th anniversary of the Dred Scott decision. And I think when we talk about civil rights, we have to talk about the place where the U.S. Supreme Court, the highest court in this country, and the Chief Justice of that court made a statement that tells us exactly what black people were thought of in 1857. And to borrow a little phrase here, in 1857, black people, black lives did not matter at all. Okay, if you know any of the quotes from that case, one of the famous ones is that black people had no rights that white people were bound to respect. And many people say that this was the worst Supreme Court decision ever rendered. It's filled with a lot of racist language. And obviously people think that this case also led to one of the main causes of the Civil War happening. So just a little background on the case. Dred Scott was a slave along with his wife, Harriet Scott. And at that time, really, the case got to the Supreme Court in 1857, but it had been litigated for like 11 years in other courts. So from 1846, really, we have a lot of cases and finally reaching the Supreme Court. And the issue for Dred Scott is that he had a lawsuit and he wanted to be free. And he had a basis for claiming that he and his wife should be free. And that is because they had, at one point, an owner that traveled a lot, and this owner took them from state to state. And at some point took them to free states, where there were doctrines that if you, as a slave, went to a free state, once free, you're gonna be free. And so when that owner died, and then another owner took over the Scotts, they had two daughters as well, eventually they wound up in Missouri, where that was not a slave. That was not a free state, it was a slave state. And so in Missouri, St. Louis, to be precise, the Scots wanted to rest on that doctrine of once free, always free. And they won. They were successful at the state level, but their new masters, and particularly the brother of the wife of the new master, challenged the rulings in Missouri. And the case went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court, and Justice Taney, the Chief Justice, if you look at his name, T-A-N-E-Y, you may not want to pronounce it Taney, but that's what it's actually pronounced. He made that hard ruling that black people were not citizens in the Constitution and had no rights. And not just slave, but free blacks had no rights whatsoever, according to the Constitution, and the Supreme Court being the interpreter of that Constitution. You can imagine how devastating that case was. And it's important, I think, to begin there. And I also want to touch on what happened just a couple of months after that decision. Frederick Douglass, we all know him from the abolitionist movement, he made a speech in Rochester, New York. And I want to really read some of the excerpts of that speech because it talks about this decision. And he made the speech in May based on the Dred Scott decision, and he did not mince words. Being a former slave himself and being a strong advocate for civil rights for black people, he called this case an abomination. And he even discussed Taney in his speech as being demonic. And that actually, words like he is the incarnation of wolfishness and the decision was a devilish decision. And I just want you to know how this galvanized the people during this time. Just some other quotes. He says, slave owners have a decided advantage over all opposition. And the advantage is complete organization. They are organized. The state governments, the church organizations, federal government, Navy, Army, magistrates, law enforcement. Basically, he said, the pen, the purse, and the sword are united against the simple truth. And he said that's one view to look at the result of the Dred Scott decision at this time. Another view, he said, was to look at it like David and Goliath. He made a lot of, in this speech, references to a moral authority, a higher authority. And he said that oppression, organized as ours, will appear invincible, like Goliath appeared invincible to David, but up to the very hour of its fall. And so the anti-slavery movement, although it looked small and it started small, it didn't have capital, that's money, it didn't have men capital, the odds were against it, but really it had nothing to lose and everything to gain. And as a result of the exposing to the nation of the horrors and the brutality of slavery and the viewpoints that were expressed in Dred Scott, he believed that this was the time and it's necessary now to make that change. And he saw hope in the decision of Dred Scott. Right? He said, this decision, in my view, is a means of keeping the nation awake on the subject. It is another proof that God does not mean that we should go to sleep and forget that we are a slave-holding nation. He also felt that slavery was a doomed system and that nothing could save it from extermination, whether it's going to be in peace or in blood. Slavery is doomed to cease. And again, advocating the overthrow of slavery to him did not mean necessarily going against the Constitution, because he felt very strongly that Chief Justice Taney misinterpreted the Constitution. If we look at the introductory words to it, okay, he said it really does not advocate slavery. You don't find the word slavery, you don't find the word slaveholders explicitly in the Constitution. And so one thing is to look at the plain language of it and to actually see that the liberties that are there should not be mistaken as only belonging to white people. And so he, unlike others, like in the abolitionist movement who wanted to burn the Constitution, he wasn't going that route, but again, he was very strong at this time in saying that this decision was devilish and enough was enough. So in 1857, this is the atmosphere. The next thing I think to point out is obviously the Civil War. It did happen soon after Dred Scott decision in 1861. And then we have an executive order. We hear a lot about executive orders too. Okay. But we have an executive order from President Lincoln coming that you may know more as a proclamation, which it started as a proclamation in 1862. And in 1863, January 1st, the Emancipation Proclamation. And in terms of, again, the framework for civil rights in this nation, the Emancipation Proclamation is very important as an executive order, but again, you have to have a basis for, as a president, for bypassing Congress, as we know. And so the basis for President Lincoln doing this was the War Powers Act. And as commander-in-chief at a time when states were leaving the Union. So the Emancipation Proclamation did not apply to the entire nation, only to those states that had left the Union. And it states it that way in the language. And then not only does it apply to those states, but some of the states, not the entire state, just the part, like example, Louisiana, not and the Emancipation Proclamation says what parts it applies to. The parts, again, that were in rebellion, and not all of Virginia, okay? There was part of Virginia at that time that today we know as West Virginia that, again, it did not apply to. So this was an executive order, and after 1863, then we have, at the end of the Civil War, we have, again, this framework for civil rights, we have the 13th Amendment. And the 13th Amendment, ratified December of 1865, was the abolition of slavery, constitutionally. And as we read in the language of the 13th Amendment, and I hope by now we all know that slavery was not only abolished in the states that rebelled, because now the Union is back together again, but in the entire United States and any other area in its jurisdiction, slavery is abolished. And slavery, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude shall exist within the United States. But there was an exception made, and it's a very important exception that I'm not sure we're going to discuss today through some other panel member, but that exception was except for conviction of crime. So persons convicted of a crime, persons in the criminal justice system, this 13th Amendment, abolishment of slavery, does not cover. It's an exception. The what came after 1865, we have the first Civil Rights Act in 1866. And this act was passed by both houses, and it passed very well. It was not just, you know, getting by. It was a good majority of both houses, the first Civil Rights Act of our nation. However, after it was passed, the president at that time, President Andrew Johnson, vetoed it. But there was enough support for it that they overrode the veto. And then we all know from history, later, Andrew Johnson was impeached. And then, pretty much to sum up my introduction to civil rights, we have the passage of the 14th and 15th Amendment. The 14th Amendment passed in 1868 definitely was considered the Civil Rights Amendment. And the first section really outlines the importance of it in terms of, again, legislatively, what it did for our nation in terms of civil rights. And here it says all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction are citizens. So this is the overturning of Dred Scott. Dred Scott was never overturned by the U.S. Supreme Court. It was overturned by the 13th and then the 14th Amendments. Okay, so the 13th Amendment overturning it by abolishing slavery, and the 14th Amendment by now saying that, yes, black people have civil rights. And then, of course, we know it's not limited now for race. But all persons born, naturalized, and subject to the jurisdiction are citizens of the United States and the state wherein they reside, and no state shall make or enforce any law that shall abridge these privileges, immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, and property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within his jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. And then the 15th Amendment, which is the final Civil War amendment ratified in 1870, basically says, you know, the right to vote shall not be denied or abridged on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. And that was 1870. We know it took 50 years for it to apply to women. But this is, I think, the foundation for understanding civil rights in this country. And now I guess I'd like to pass the baton. I'm not sure to whom to pass it.
Right.
But that was the introduction.
Let's stop with the history, because I actually have someone here in the room who would like to talk about the civil rights movement in the 60s later. But how would you, our three other panelists, have you ever come across cases, and as Ross said, civil rights is not only black people, it's women, you know, all kind of people who
especially in the Attorney General's office and now in private practice. I represented, like I said earlier, I represented the state of New Jersey as a Deputy Attorney General, and I was on the state of New Jersey side, so I represented them, and so people that work for the state of New Jersey would sue the state of New Jersey under the guidance of, you know, the Civil Rights Act, and they would say, you know, I'm protected, I'm in a protected class, whether it be race, color, national origin, or sex. Sex was added to the Civil Rights Act of 1964 in 1998. So that they would sue under that premise. And by the way, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission was established through the Civil Rights Act. So they would sue a lot in the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And in New Jersey, it's a federal agency, and they sue in Newark. So a lot of my cases were in Newark, New Jersey. That's where my office was. I also had an office in Trenton, but I'd have to go to represent the state of New Jersey, the Attorney General's office, and you know, the people that work there would say, you know, I was discriminated against because of my race. I was discriminated against. I did not get that promotion because I was over the age of 40. Or they would say, you know, there's a lot of different protected classes. They could say age discrimination, Americans with Disabilities Act. There's a lot of different protected classes, and they would file and institute lawsuits, and I would have to represent the state of New Jersey. And in doing so, I would have to investigate, obviously interview all the people that work there. A lot of running around the state of New Jersey up and down the turnpike, because I represented so many people, so many different establishments. Before I left, I represented the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey. So I represented the schools, the dental school, the medical school. So anytime there was any type of issue related to employment, I was the attorney that was one of the attorneys that handled those matters.
Well, the first time that I professionally became involved with and confronted disparity of treatment based on race was when I worked in the DA's office in Rockland County. From time to time, claims were made by defense counsel that not given the same benefits under the law that a white person would have been entitled to. We had to confront those. I had to confront that sort of issue in when I was in private practice. That sort of discriminatory conduct still exists. And one of the points that I was intending to make spoke was that the civil rights that we all enjoy as citizens of the United States disappear if we don't assert them, and disappear if we don't take the steps within the law to see to it that they are adhered to, and that sort of thinking doesn't work its way through our system. Sometimes it requires some degree of fortitude, but I submit that we all, as U.S. citizens, have not only a right but an obligation to understand what our civil rights are, and that we have the gumption to assert them. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that when I get to the full body.
So I'm an organizer with Black Lives Matter, specifically in Patterson, but I work with other chapters as well, including that of BLM New Jersey. So if we're going to talk government discriminates against you or allows people within your country to discriminate against you, your civil rights have been violated. It's a very simple concept to think about that. It makes sense. So when you join a group like Black Lives Matter or proclaim such a title, it's because you recognize that your civil rights have been either ignored, discriminated against in some way. I realize a lot of people have an issue with it because what people have been conditioned to believe is discrimination, racism, are the type of things that are really more overt. That's name calling, attacks, physical attacks, and the things that we can easily recognize as harmful. And what's been happening in America over decades is really more of a systemic change that's been attacking people of color, specifically Black communities, Hispanic communities, and that's really what we're fighting against now. Another thing about Black Lives Matter is that we stand in solidarity with just about everybody who's been oppressed in any fashion, and that includes all different colors and, you know, people, classes, everything. So when I hear phrases like all lives matter, or I'm sure a lot of people still really do believe that, it's really incorrect and dismissive almost of all the issues that are going on in the country, because I don't think anybody would blatantly say, although there are people that do blatantly say things like some people do not matter, it's more so that we've seen systemically that some races, some types of people, certain groups of people have literally been discriminated against and their civil rights have been violated. The problem is people don't know what that looks like now. That type of discrimination looks like things like food deserts. If you know what a food desert is, it's the fact that you don't have a supermarket in your neighborhood and you tend to shop at bodegas. It's the fact that your group of person may have health issues that you don't have access to a doctor for. And these are things that are systemically set up. It's your education system not having new books, equipment, not having proper teachers, after school programs, things like that that some of us took for granted if we grew up in the suburbs, like myself. And we don't realize that there are people that literally do not have access to these things. And because we don't see it, we don't live in these neighborhoods, we don't know what that directly looks like or how that affects people, we tend to think racism is gone, discrimination is gone, people are protesting for no reason, and we don't even know what they're mad about. Because you can go to Whole Foods and buy a decent meal for your family and cook it because you have clean water to use. If you think about Flint, Michigan, they've been bathing, eating, everything with bottled water for over a year now. And they're not the only place in this country that lives under those conditions. There's places in Mississippi, Louisiana, that suffer under those conditions too. So what is it like when you can't even take a shower or cook for your children because your government doesn't think it's appropriate to fix the pipes in your neighborhood? And then you wonder, why is that? Why does that not happen in more affluent neighborhoods, typically to white people? Why doesn't it happen there? And of course, it's not all white people either, because there are poor white people in America that suffer under some of these same conditions, and nobody really likes to talk about those groups. Like there are poor white folk in the Appalachian Mountains that suffer some of the same very harsh conditions that we think about when we think about people of color in urban cities. And these are the things that BLM really does stand in solidarity with. So when we're gonna talk about civil rights and why organizations like Black Lives Matter exist, we really do have to remember that it's not the explicit discrimination that we're all so used to hearing, the bullying that we're so used to seeing. It's more so ingrained in our system, and our system has let it persist for decades. And these are the things that we're fighting against. Of course, we'll probably get into some more details as it goes on, but that's really what we're fighting against now.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm sorry, I'm monitoring the recording. And I noticed that you all prepared something, and Ross already spoke. Do you have anything that you would like to add to the topic before we go to the questions? Sure, go ahead, please.
The few remarks that I prepared focus on a fairly narrow issue that has come up in recent days. And I want to just briefly talk about a couple of those issues because, frankly, the literature and the information that's out there civil rights, Americans' civil rights, would fill enough books to fill this room 5 or 10 times over. And but in order to give it some context, and please forgive me if this is repetitive or too elemental for what you've already learned in your classes. I want to talk about the fundamental core documents from which all other rules emanate through the pronouncements of the Supreme Court of the United States. You know, the Constitution was enacted in September of 1787, and the Bill of Rights was enacted in December of 1791. The Bill of Rights is the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, and the 14th Amendment was enacted in June of 1866. The first 10 amendments are commonly referred to as the Bill of Rights, and the 14th Amendment, which, among other things, cleared up whether there was any question about whether the first 10 amendments applied to the states, because as it was initially construed, the Bill of Rights was not believed to apply to the states, only to the federal government. That question was eliminated by the 14th Amendment. Now, I'm not going to go through every provision in the Bill of Rights. What I'm going to try and do is just focus, because there's just a mountain of information and things to discuss. I wanted to limit my discussion to some of the, or one or two of the issues that has arisen because of the actions of our newly elected president. The First Amendment, among other things, I'm trying to limit this, states that Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of a religion, shall not impair the freedom of speech or of the press, and the right of the people to peaceably assemble in order to petition the government for a redress of grievances. This is kind of a core concept for our form of government. However flawed it is, this is one of the gemstones in modern government.
So do you see with the, in the current situation, you just mentioned a couple of civil rights,
yeah.
The assembly, yes? And now we have journalists who are being persecuted for providing the information of from the meetings. So do you see that we are going to have many civil rights cases in the court?
So in my opinion, the answer to that question is yes, because apparently the President of the United States believes that it is permissible for him to browbeat the press in order to silence them. And it's constitutionally prohibited, and I don't think he's going to stop, and I hope the press doesn't stop to assert their rights to a free speech. The 14th Amendment, aside from making born or naturalized in the United States as subject to the jurisdiction thereof, as having all the same rights, civil rights, as everyone else, and that everyone is entitled to the equal protection of the laws, and that every person is entitled to due process of law. Judges who have been, people who have been judges for many, many years, who are very quite bright and very serious students of American government and jurisdiction, have tried to define what due process is. They haven't been able to do a great job of it. But due process is a right that every citizen, irrespective of religion, race, is entitled to have the protection of a whole panoply of rights, which in their aggregate protect American citizens from an oppressive government. Now, one of the things that, that came up very recently in current civil affairs is our president's travel ban prohibiting citizens from 7 designated countries from traveling to the United States. Now the problem is that the president has espoused the notion that that ban is not subject to judicial review. Our president has said that he has the right to determine citizens from which country are allowed to travel to our country, and that a judge is not authorized to question the validity of that. And you know, that claim is not consistent with the form of government we have. We have an executive branch of government, which is the top is the president. We have a legislative branch, which is the Congress. And we have a judicial branch, which is the judges. And it is the role of the judges to interpret what Congress does and what the president does in the context of the Constitution of the United States of America and its amendments. So to say that the courts do not have authority to review the president's actions with regard to who can come to this country and who can't, it's just, it's not an accurate description of the law and the history of the law in this country. Now, why is that important? Well, the importance of it, I think, can be found in what the, I think pretty sure it's the Ninth Circuit said in its decision refusing to strike down the stay that the local court in federal court imposed and stopping the federal government from the executive branch from imposing these travel bans. Number one, according to the words of one of the judges on that district court, that federal district court, it was the most blatant and obvious discrimination based on religious beliefs that he had ever encountered in his career as a judge. Because there was no finding, there were no facts offered in support of the executive order banning people to emigrate to our country from those 7 designated countries. They were not given due process. They were not entitled to a hearing. They were not entitled to an attorney. They were not afforded the equal protection of the law that is equal to holders of green cards and visas. A green card is a written acknowledgement by the federal government that the holder of that card is lawfully a permanent resident in the United States. That person is therefore entitled to the same protection that I am. I don't have a green card. But the people from the 7 designated countries are entitled to be treated under the law equally as I am. The visa is just it's stapled to your passport when you want to come to the United States, and it permits you to make short-term visits and short-term employment here in the United States. Our president alleges in support of his executive order that he doesn't have to make a showing of any kind why that ban is appropriate or necessary for the protection of the United States. The judges happen to disagree with him. Now, judges have been disagreeing with presidents of this country for 100 years, probably longer. But what seems to be new on the stage of history is that of the ways that that became particularly vehement in the public domain is something that I personally believe is going to come up again and again, and that's the concept of anger babies. It's been a concept that's been under hot dispute for 100 years. Right now, under the current interpretation of our Constitution, rendered by the judicial branch, and that can be found in the 1965 Immigration Act, is that when someone is born in the United States, they are automatically a citizen of the United States. And when a child is born in the United States, it confers certain rights on the parents of that child. It allows the parents of that child to come to the United States without becoming citizens. There are many Americans who object to that, and I think this is going to be a recurring legal contest, because the objectives to that anchor baby meaning when that baby is born in this country, it anchors the family in this country so that other members of the family can come here. And as the objection goes, get free medical care, welfare, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't think that this legal contest is going away. It's gone back and forth between the federal judges and the legislature. And
so can you say anything about the case of the Mexican mother who was deported? So since her children are here legally, can she now apply
illegally
for the
watch, we're going to hear all of this next week.
Okay.
You should want the other one. Yeah.
I definitely do have my passport.
Good for you. Good for you.
What?
I never had issues.
I don't know.
Right? I can't relate. I can't. Because you can relate to something. So you're only there, but then you really can't experience.
And I see what you're saying.